These networking levels from Protostar are not really security related, but they are great to do some first simple network programming. And just for the sake of having a complete series from exploit exercises, we will solve these challenges too. The previous two videos were already a good introduction to networking, sockets, TCP and, so let's build on this foundation by writing a Python script to interact with this program over the network. Especially for CTFs, this is an important part because for many challenges you interact with a service over TCP. So the exploit you write has to do this over the network. Let's have a look at this level. I won't go over the meaning of all these unknown functions because we have done so in episode Hex 19. As we see in the defines, or simply by checking netstat on the VM, we can see that net level 1 is running on port 2998. Again, we could use netcat to talk to the servers, but this time we want to write a Python script. But let's first have a look at the run function. First, run generates a random unsigned integer, and then we sprintf the number into fub. We haven't seen sprintf before, so other than regular printf, which writes the resulting string to stdout, sprintf will write the resulting string to the address specified in the first argument, in this case buff. This means fub will contain the decimal representation of the number in ASCII and not contain the raw byte values. Then write will write to the socket, thus sending us the integer number, thus the raw bytes. That's what we saw returned by netcat. After that, the program will wait for user input with fgets. Once we send some data, it will overwrite any new line or carriage return with null byte. This makes sense because when we, for example, use netcat and hit enter to send something, it will include a new line at the end because that's a key we pressed. But obviously, this program only wants the characters we actually meant to send, thus stripping away the new line. Then it compares the original number with the number it received and either prints success or fail. So let's start to write our Python script. But how do we do that? Maybe a first hint on how to do network programming could be to look at how netcat connects to a server, so we can use strace to trace all syscalls of netcat. Now let's try to identify the important ones, and then we try to figure out how to implement them in Python. First one is obviously the call to socket. So let's look into Python socket documentation on how to do that in our script. So the call to socket uses parameters pfenet and socstream. And when we look here in the Python doc, we see something very similar, except that it suggests to use af enet. So I wonder what's the difference between pf and af enet. So I Google, and surprisingly, it turns out that this is a remnant of an idea that never really took off. And in fact, in the Linux kernel, it's now simply defined as being the same as af enet. Huh, learned something today. And the Python doc then uses connect to a hostname or an IP and port, which we can see in the strace. Here it's called with port 2998 and the IP address 127001. So we can also just use that. Cool. Now we can use send and receive with the socket. Obviously we want to read the number that is sent to us, so we use receive, but we have to specify how much data we want to read. In this case we expect an unsigned integer which is 32-bit large, thus we have to read 4 bytes. Now let's simply print the data we receive and then test it. Cool. By the way, I also noticed that when we request a new number very quickly, that a lot of numbers are the same and not random. That's because in the code, the random number generator is seeded by the time in seconds. Thus, if we send fast enough, the second will be the same and thus produce the same pseudo-random number. Don't you ever use a non-random source or a seed for a pseudo-random number generator if it's important. And now it's easy to solve it because we are already very experienced with converting numbers to raw bytes and raw bytes to numbers from all the exploits with memory values that we have written. So we can simply use the struct module and convert raw binary data back to an unsigned integer and then send it as a string back to the server. Remember that struct unpack returns a tuple, so the actual unpack number is the first element. It seems to hang. Let's try it again. Now it seems to work. The receive hangs when it is waiting for data and doesn't get any, so I assume the server sends too fast and there is no buffer buffering the data, and when we are finally ready to receive data, the data is already lost in the void. Anyhow, it worked. Doesn't have to be perfect, as long as you succeed once the attack was successful. This episode is so short, and these challenges are not really about security anyway, so let's quickly solve the next one too. Net2 is very similar. We again have a network setup with a program listening on port 2997. In the run function, we see a for loop that runs 4 times, and each time it generates a random number, adds it to the sum of them all, and sends it over the network. The description also says that we have to add 4 32-bit integers, and it already warns us about the possibility of it wrapping. Or in proper terms, it warns us about an integer overflow, which again is security relevant. Okay, so let's copy our previous script and quickly modify it to read 4 integers and then calculate the sum. We can simply extend the struct unpack modifier, and then we can also just create a sum over the resulting tuple. Easy as that. The code expects the result not in an ASCII decimal representation but as a raw binary, so we can use struct pack to convert it to a binary string and then send it. Oh, I wanted to show that this doesn't work because of the integer overflow. If we have a look at the result of the sum in binary, we can see that it contains more than 32 bits, and that cannot be. An integer is only 32-bit large, so what happens is that the integer is simply overflowing or wrapping around. This means the carry of the highest bit is just lost. Well, it's not entirely true. The CPU is actually aware of this when an arithmetic operation such as an addition ends up overflowing the value in a register, a special overflow flag is set that could be checked. But anyway, in this case, our unsigned integer on the server always wrap around. And apparently this old Python struct version actually did that for us, but this behavior got deprecated, so we can simply do the same in our code. As I said, the issue is called integer overflow, and when you search for this, you will find many bug reports about it. Let's make a simple example of a typical integer overflow issue. Let's say you have a loop that keeps reading data and adds the size to an overall size variable. Once it's done with the loop, it will know for how much data it has to allocate space for. The issue is now, if you manage to send so much data that the counter overflows, wraps around, a smaller space is allocated for the huge amounts of data, and then you have a typical overflow condition. We are slowly heading into the final levels of exploit exercises protostar, and we start to see a little bit more intricate challenges. So let's stay focused and tackle the next.